Hey everyone, good morning. Welcome to your fireside chat from Mike's Pure Art class this morning. Today we're going to be making a wine goblet stem. This is what you can do in the make your own wine goblet class. So I'm going to grab a sample really quick to show you the wine goblets. So, there are three different styles of goblets you can make in our class. The first is the kind of standard red wine goblet. Hold this back here so you can see it a little better. This one is modeling an hourglass stem, thinner in the middle, thicker towards the ends. Could also choose a champagne flute. This one's got our football-shaped stem. Then we also have the martini glass. This one's doing more of a cylinder stem. It's not a perfect cylinder, but it's more of a straight line for the profile of the stem. So, you guys are the artists, so in the class, you will decide what style of cup you want, and then what style of stem. Now, again, you guys are the artists, so if you're making your stem and you like it kind of lumpy and bumpy and more organic, that's fine, you can stop there. But as instructors, we want to know that. So if you were going to shoot for the football and now you've changed your mind, you want to leave it lumpy and bumpy, tell us that, because otherwise we're going to keep trying to get you to make it a football even though you don't want to. So in the demo today, I'm going to walk through all three of these goblet style shapes. One leads to the next. We're going to do the football first. We'll stretch it out into the hourglass and then finally into a cylinder. So we're going to walk you through those three shapes because they're the most common and the easiest to achieve. But again, you're the artist, so if you feel otherwise inclined, we can kind of accommodate that within a reason. We do want these to be durable and something that you feel comfortable using, that it's not something that you just set on the shelf and never touch because you're worried about breaking it. So durability is really key. For that reason, we do want to make sure folks never go any thinner than the center of this stem. That's about 8 millimeters. That's actually the same diameter as the clear glass rod we're going to be using today. So never any thinner than that, and also never any longer than about 3 to 3.5 inches. So by the time we connect up your stem at 3.5 inches, it jumps to about a 4-inch space between the foot and the cup because there's a little clear attachment points there. So if you get carried away and make a really giant stem that's super tall, you're gonna end up with a cup that's, you know, really tall, really tippy, and as you get tipsy, the tippier your cup is, you know, the worse things happen. So we don't want any wine spilling on the carpet or the couch or your goblet breaking because it tipped over. So we want it, you know, no longer than about 3 inches for your stem, and then no thinner than that 8 millimeter. So here's kind of a finished stem. This is one one of our glassblowers, Andrew, made. This is for our production goblets that we do. I call this more of a baseball bat shape. It's just got a nice taper to it. But that's like that 3.5-inch mark. That's plenty long. So to achieve that, we are going to pick out up to 3 colors and mix that with about 3 inches of clear glass. So we're gonna, again, use this 8 millimeter clear glass rod. And I've got my 3 colors here. I'm gonna use cobalt, white, and Lake Superior green. And a little bit of color goes a long way. So on average, you're gonna use about 1 inch of color of each of these and then mix that down with 1 inch of clear for each color. So you'll have about 3 inches of clear mixed in with about 3 inches of color. Now, some colors are very dense, some are really light. The cobalt is a really dense one. So I'm gonna go very, very mild on the cobalt, maybe 1/2 inch. And probably a little heavier on the teal or Lake Superior green to really make that stand out. So, yes, Gary, that was a finished stem. It is also a finished stem ready for assembly. So yeah, that's kind of a quick overview of what we'll be doing. I'm gonna go over the rules again, just so that you guys are familiar with this when you're watching before you come for your class. The biggest rule is you always have to keep spinning. Okay, that glass is gonna be molten on the end. And if you stop spinning, whether you're in the flame or out of it, that glass wants to start drooping towards the earth. So always, always, always keep spinning. The next rule is 2 inches of clearance from the face of your torch here. Okay, we'll pretend there's a flame coming out. If you're really close to the torch and that glass is molten and you slip up with your grip or you sneeze or look away for a photo to smile and that hot glass were to touch the face of the torch, it's gonna stick to the torch and plug it and ruin them. And the torches are, you know, $400 or $500 a piece. So always keep 2 inches of clearance from the face of that torch. We're gonna start at the end of the flame, slowly working in, and then get down to about that 2 to 4 inch working zone. There we go, somewhere in there. And that's a really safe area to work. You'll see when the flame is lit, in person, probably not on the camera, there's little white candles that are about an inch off the face of the torch, and then it's a blue flame from that. If you're ever in that 1 inch candle region, you're way too close. So always spin 2 inches of clearance. And then the last rule is what we call no stringers. That comes into play when you've mixed two pieces together and you're going to disconnect them. You have to stay in the flame as you pull apart to disconnect. You know, the instinct is right. You do want to pull apart, but if you come out of the flame and pull, it's just like taffy and that glass gets thinner and thinner and thinner, becomes hair thin strands of glass, which are super dangerous. And they make awful slivers. I've got them. I've got a few in my hands permanently from years of just working around glass. So stay in the flame. It'll feel like you're pulling a stringer because it gets thinner, but as it gets thin enough, that flame will eventually pierce through and separate the glass. So those are our main rules. Practice spinning at home. Grab a chopstick and put some honey on the end of it. Try to keep that honey on the chopstick. It's a really good drill to get the hang of that. And we're just going like a nice steady rotation. Nothing too crazy fast. I prefer to spin towards myself. You can see my thumbs are pushing down. If you prefer to spin away from yourself with your thumbs pushing up, that's fine as well. The only rule about the direction that you spin is that both hands need to be going in the same direction if the rods are pointed in a straight line. So we say point the same, spin the same. And then when we mix, we're gonna point them opposite, kind of like a 90 degree angle. Then you can spin opposite. So pointed the same, spin the same, pointed opposite, spin opposite. We call that wringing out the towel as well. It's a really good mixing technique, but it's pretty aggressive, and you're never gonna get a smooth piece of glass if you're spinning opposite directions. You think about a towel gets those ribbons in it when you, or a dishcloth when you wring it out. Same thing will happen with the glass. So pointed the same, spin the same, pointed opposite, spin the opposite. And it's a lot to think about. It's kind of like patting your head and rubbing your belly. If you're having a hard time figuring that out, watch your thumbs. They should be doing the same thing at the same time. Okay? If they're not, either you're spinning out of sync and you're alternating, which is also going to potentially corkscrew, or they're definitely going opposite at the same time, then you know you're spinning opposite. So that's kind of the last rule is spin, no stringers. Spin the same direction when they're pointed the same, spin opposite when they're pointed opposite. So, with that, we've kind of covered all of the bases about how things are going to work, some of those ground rules. We'll take care of lighting your torch and adjusting that, so you don't have to worry about that at all. Alright, so we like to start with the clear glass in your non-dominant hand and then the colored glass in your dominant hand. It's a little bit easier to control that way using your dominant hand. Always wearing our specialized glass blowing glasses that filter out the bright orange flame. I'm going to start with my darkest color first, that cobalt blue, just so I can kind of tell how much gets mixed in. It's really easy to put way too much color in, and especially when it's your second and third color, it's hard to tell which color is which because they're all just glowing orange. So start with your darkest, and when you think you've put in almost enough, it probably means you've put in plenty already. So we're gonna start near the end of the flame, letting the tips of those rods slowly warm up. And then every 5 or 10 seconds, you're gonna leapfrog, bringing the one from the back of the flame into the front of the flame. This just helps them heat up nice and easy. I had to turn my music down during all that because there was a ripping guitar solo and I was like, yeah, this is probably distracting. So maybe I'll turn it up in a minute here. So now that they're both super hot, I'm ready to join them together. I'll take them out of the flame so you can see. They're both glowing and they'll droop a little bit if they're not on the flame, okay? So they're both super hot, ready to join together. If they touch before you intended to join them, don't worry about it. That's no big deal, it's the next step anyway, so just roll with it. We'll touch them together in the flame, keep spinning, always, always, always spin. And I'm gonna show you, once it cools, hopefully you'll be able to see where the color meets the clear there. So you can see the clear has lost its glow before the color did. And the point I'm trying to make here is that when you stick colors together like this, if you don't ever turn them to that 90 degree angle to mix, your colors will just stack up kind of like a roll of lifesavers. And so mixing is really fun to do with the hot glass, and you get a much prettier swirled look to it. So that's why we mix. If you don't, you just get stacks of colors. So we'll get these hot again. Now that it's hot, you go to that 90 degree angle and switch directions with one hand. That's going to make us spin opposite directions. So for our first color, we're looking for a glob of glass. I don't know, about the diameter of like a blueberry. If it's a non-organic blueberry, one of those giant GMO Dole ones, that's plenty. We're also not looking probably for like the teeny tiny BWCA blueberries either. So something kind of like, you know, middle of the road, average grocery store blueberry. This one's even a little big. This is pushing that jumbo Dole GMO size blueberry. But that's plenty for my first color. So when you've got enough of your first color mixed in, lift out of the flame, keep spinning, let that glass cool down so it gains some rigidity again. And then we're ready to disconnect. We're gonna disconnect right next to the glob here where that colored rod meets my glob. And this is where that no stringer rule comes into play. So keep it in the flame, slowly pull apart, and that flame will just pierce right through. Now, if you forget and you come out of the flame, you're gonna pull a stringer. You see that? That's hair thin. That's literally, yeah, not much thicker than a piece of hair. That's what all of our internet comes through now, is fiber optic cables. It's these bundles of hair-thin strands of glass. That's how it can bend around corners like a cable would, even though it's glass. So these are super dangerous. They make awful slivers, and they're really springy. I've had them on my bench and dropped something on them, and they've sprung up and almost hit me in the eye. So that's why, two of the main reasons why we don't want to pull stringers. If we do, we're going to melt this down in the flame. This will shoot little balls of glass across the bench sometimes, so be mindful, tell the person across from you, heads up. All right, our stringer has been safely contained, and now we're ready to move on to the next color. When I use white, especially with two transparent colors like this, we always recommend using it in the middle. It really helps to set off both of the colors. And so I've got the white glass here next. I'm keeping my blueberry right in the front of the flame to get it nice and hot. We want to keep our glob super hot the whole time because that's going to help our new color get mixed throughout. Then I'll leapfrog a few times, making sure that white rod gets nice and hot. Andy Gregorich, I'm going to have to ask you to stop watching. This is a beginner class, not a master level class. So you're probably going to see some things in here that maybe wouldn't apply for those of the master caliber. Andy's a phenomenal glassblower, originally from northern Minnesota near where I grew up, and now lives in Rice Lake, Wisconsin area, and does absolutely incredible clean and detailed work. So cool to see him joining in. All right, we're ready to add this next color now. We'll stick them together just like we did before. Bend to that 90 degree angle, then switch directions to wring out that towel. And as we're doing this, we're kind of pushing together a little bit, feeding in glass into this glob. This time we're probably looking for a glob about the diameter of an organic grape, not one of the jumbo cotton candy ones. And this white color we're using is actually one of the only colors that tends to blend a little bit. So generally glass colors, for the purpose of our intro classes, they don't mix, they just swirl together. Kind of like a Lake Superior agate, the more you mix, the thinner the bands of color become. But the white does blend a little bit, so that's just something to note. So, I'm pretty happy with that. Probably a little smaller than an organic grape, but it's about the right size. So I've come out of the flame, I straightened it back out, so I'm spinning the same direction, letting things cool down for a few seconds. Then we'll go back to the flame and slowly pull it apart, making sure we don't pull any stringers, just like that. Always set the rods of glass when you're done with them with the hot end pointing away from you. If you flip them the other way, you might bump that hot end when you're going for another one. And the glass is deceivingly hot. So even though it's not glowing at all anymore, the tip of this is still probably, 900 degrees or so. And it's gonna be hot enough to burn me for almost 5 minutes. So be very, very careful with any glass you've had in the flame recently, because if it's been in the flame in the last 5 minutes, there's a good chance it could burn you. All right, now we're gonna add our last color. Making sure my glob stays nice and hot, that's gonna help that last color get mixed throughout our whole stem. Both nice and hot. We'll join them together in the flame. Bring it to that 90 degree angle. Spin opposite directions. Now as your glob gets bigger, it's gonna be harder to spin. You're gonna encounter more resistance, and that's totally normal. But if you're at this 90 and you're just cranking on it and it's hardly moving at all, it means it's not hot enough. So if that's the case, straighten it out, spin the same direction. It should never be hard to spin when you're in the same direction, or when you're pointed the same direction. If it is, you're probably wringing out the towel. Okay, so we're same direction, spinning the same. We'll build up a bunch of heat in the glob. And then in about another 15 seconds or so, we can bring it back to that 90 and it should be a lot easier to mix. If you didn't catch our pendant making video last week from our pendant making class, a lot of these steps are exactly the same. We kind of limit that one typically to two colors, but it all starts out the same, and then it's just how we shape it at the end that determines whether it's a pendant or a wine goblet stem. All right, it's nice and hot. We're gonna go back to that 90, wring out the towel. And you can really have fun at this point. If you wanna kind of stretch things out, coil it up on one, pass it back and forth. You can almost knead it like it's dough. It's a really fun time to play with hot glass. It's a lot like taffy at this point. I've never worked with taffy, but from what I hear, it's very similar, all depending on how hot the glass is, of course. So have fun with it, mix it up. Just an awesome opportunity to try playing around with hot glass with really no poor consequences from doing it. We don't care what the shape looks like. That's a really big concern a lot of students express. They're like, oh my God, it looks like a poop emoji. Well, we're not worried about the shape yet. We're just mixing, getting all these colors blended together. And then once we have enough glass mixed together, then we're ready to start our shaping. So I'm about there. So we're going for a diameter of a glob that's maybe about the diameter of a quarter or one of those jumbo like cotton candy grapes. So you can kind of see as I rotate it, this is pretty lumpy and bumpy. It's not a very uniform shape right now. So that's our next step, is to get this uniform. So I like to work one half at a time. You can see it's a little elongated. I'm gonna work on my left side first. And that helps us maintain control. When this glob gets super hot to the point where the glass wants to really flow as a liquid, if we have both connection points on our handles really hot, it's super hard to control. So Working half of your glob at a time will really help you maintain control. The tendency at this point is that people want to force the glass into a symmetrical shape, but that never works. Glass is, you know, just like any other material, it's going to have an equal and opposite reaction. So even though you might push it to where you think you want it, it's going to bow out somewhere else as a result from that. So the only way to achieve uniformity is by spinning in the flame and just getting it super hot. Once that glass becomes more liquid, centrifugal force just wants to help round it out and make it nice and uniform. So now you can see the profile on my left side is much more uniform. My right side still has a few little bumps in it. So now that the left side's good, we're gonna let that cool. And then I'll jump over to the right side and melt the rest of that in nice and smooth. So you can see that heat gradient now. Now that it's cooling more, you can see that my left side's still way hotter than the right. All right, so now we're gonna jump to the right side, do the same thing there. At this point, when you're shaping your stem, when it gets really liquid, the glass is gonna respond to whatever pressures you're putting on it. So if it's getting really thin and you're like kind of like pulling the stringer and losing control, it means you're pulling apart. You might not feel like you are, but it can be as simple as this. I'll show you in a sec here. I'm in a straight line spinning now. If you're letting the weight of the glass pull down and bow out in the middle, you're gonna pull a stringer. So just simply by not supporting the glass rods, that glass will wanna stretch apart. Conversely, if you're spinning and heating and you're getting this like disc or tire shape, that means you're squeezing together. And again, you might not feel like you are. The same thing can happen if it's super hot and you're letting it fall together. It's gonna squeeze into a disc. So just watch the glass. It'll tell you what pressures you're putting on it. And then you just need to do the opposite. So if it's getting thin on you and you don't feel like you're pulling apart, you'll have to actively think about squeezing together just a little bit. Almost the act of thinking about it is enough to make it happen. That's how subtle the pressures are when the glass is super hot. All right. So now my right side is more uniform and smooth. And this is our football shape. So if you want a nice, short, squatty kind of stem, this is where we'd stop and we'd work on connecting up to the goblet at this point. The squatty stems are nice, especially even on the red wine goblet. It turns it into a little bit more like a stout glass or a whiskey snifter. Also is a little more durable, lowers that center of gravity, and it's a much thicker piece of glass. So that's a great, great shape to keep. That's our football. Next, we're gonna go to that hourglass shape. So to do that, we're gonna heat up the very middle, get that super hot, and then out of the flame, give it a little stretch to thin out the center. Now at this point, I like to ride a little below the flame, so that flame skims over the top. And that makes sure that I don't heat up the tips of that football. If the tips of the football get hot, then it's hard to control. So you watch my flame when I do that again. Here's my flame when I'm riding underneath the flame, and that flame is skimming the top. If I'm centered in the flame, that flame shoots off to both sides and heats at the tip of the football. So we always want to ride below the flame to decrease the amount of the width of the glass that we're getting hot. Now this is starting to stretch on its own a little bit. I'm not putting any pressure on here to pull. It's just doing it, but that tells me I'm ready to come out. You can see it's gotten longer already. And now as it cools out of the flame, I'm gonna stretch and spin at the same time to stretch out that hourglass. So with the heat that I had in there, that was a really easy, subtle move. I didn't have to pull very hard at all. Sometimes when I see students have the right amount of heat and they've got a really big mass of glass, I'll have them come out and just pull and stop spinning. I'll say death grip it and just pull, because I know that the heat is there, and if they just pull really hard, we can get a good shape. That's not the ideal way to do it, but it is one method that I use sometimes if folks are struggling to get an even shape and control the glass, is we'll use a little more force and a little less heat. So there's our hourglass. Right now, you can even see how blue that is. I used just a little bit of that cobalt, quite a bit of white, which is giving it that cloudy look, and this teal, and I hardly see any teal in this right now. It's pretty subtle. Now, if you wanted to go to the more of the cylinder look where it's a straight line, you're just gonna treat the two ends of the hourglass like they're footballs. So we'll heat up one football at a time and give it a little stretch to get more of a cylindrical shaped stem. The cylinder is the hardest shape to do, so just know that. And again, as I stress in all of my videos, we strongly encourage the 80% rule. When you're 80% happy, it might be time to be 100% done. Because if you keep messing with it, you're gonna end up, you know, 60% happy or having to start all over. All right, so I got it nice and hot. It's still a football, I'm not stretching yet. There's too much heat. So I come out of the flame, and then as it cools, then I'll start to pull apart to get more of that cylindrical shape. I didn't quite get it on that one, so I'm gonna heat the center of that football once more. Give it a little stretch. And now we've got a little bit more of that cylindrical shape. Okay? Now that being said, our stem's gonna get pretty tall if I stretch both of those out. This is already almost 4 inches from the bottom of the stem here to the top of the stem there. It's almost 4 inches. So it's a really good time to say, you know what? I like the shape of it. I'm not gonna mess with it anymore. It's 80%. So now we're gonna work on disconnecting and getting ready to hook up to our stem. Jackie likes the 80% rule. Awesome. So, you can look at this in both orientations and decide what the top and bottom is. So there's no right or wrong way to do it. It's all personal preference. You're the artist, so you decide. I personally usually like the thicker end towards the bottom. So we're gonna disconnect there and disconnect the same way we have every other time, getting it nice and hot and slowly pull apart. Amber, what do you mean you can't do it? Anyone can do it. That's what our intro classes are for. We teach people with no experience and they come out of every class with beautiful pieces of glasswork. So we're gonna slowly pull apart, disconnect, and let that flame cut right through. All right. So this is where you as the student is gonna stop. So connecting it up to the cup and the foot are the really hard parts. So myself or one of our instructors are gonna do that step while you enjoy some complimentary wine. And right now, for another $25, you could do a whole other stem for a goblet if you didn't want, you know, be like, you know what? I can drink wine at home. I wanna make another goblet and make a set. For $25, you can start right onto another one and we'll connect them both up for you and then you'll come away with a pair from the class. So, I'll give you a little bit closer view of that. Again, it's really, really blue. You can see where it's on the teal rod there. You know, that teal color is there, but once it's in a mixture, you don't see much. So the mixtures are fun like that. It's a really hard thing to predict, but that's half the fun is when you get to see your piece finish. Some colors change in the kiln, and so you never quite know exactly how it's gonna look. So yeah, that's how to make a goblet stem. And that's one of our 3 introduction flamework classes. Don't need any experience to do them. They're really fun and folks have a great time. The goblet one is super awesome for date nights or bachelorette parties or bachelor parties. And even, you know, family classes. You know, a lot of times folks will come in the holidays and, you know, rather than going to the movies with the family and not talking to each other, come in and blow some glass and try a new experience. So. Yeah, that's just one of our 3 intro classes, and hopefully in, you know what, another month or so maybe that people are talking that maybe we'll be open up again, depending on how things go, but we appreciate everyone's support, appreciate you tuning in and watching. Jody is continuing to add more sale items to our clearance section. I've seen a few sales come through for that just this morning, so thank you guys so much for that. These are cool pieces, again, that we've just had around, and They're maybe not, maybe we've had them too long or just don't have a spot for them in our gallery with other products that look similar or, you know, don't have a cohesive grouping. So it's a great opportunity to get some really great pieces at awesome prices. So check out the website. Keep supporting small businesses as much as you can by gift certificates. You know, we really need your help. We don't have the deep pockets that the big corporations do to kind of weather these times. So thank you guys so much for tuning in. That was the Wine Goblet demo. And let's see, tomorrow, what do we have on the agenda? Tomorrow I'm doing a rose. So the roses are one of the very first things I learned how to make in my apprenticeship about 17 years ago. And I'll be doing this one as a memorial piece. I've got an order for it. So it'll be a great opportunity to show you guys how I sculpt a rose and do a custom order at the same time. So speaking of that, we still have our designer pendant event going on. So come on down to the website, submit an idea for your pendant. We might not be able to make all of them, but throw your idea in the ring and we'll tell you what we think is feasible. And yeah, it's a fun challenge. I did a sailboat last week, which is a super cool way to test my sculpting abilities live on Facebook. So that's our deal. So thanks again, you guys. Appreciate the support, and we will see you tomorrow at 10 o'clock. Take care.